Enviro Close-Up is made possible in part by a grant from Greensphere.
Andrew Kimbrell, next on Enviro Close-Up. Welcome to Enviro Close-Up. I am Carl Grossman in New York, speaking to Andrew Kimbrell out at San Rafael, California at the 14th Annual Bioneers Conference. Kimbrell is an attorney, an activist, and an author, and founder of the International Center for Technology Assessment. He has been challenging quite actively in recent years genetic engineering, nanotechnology, and corporate globalization. Where are those three things headed as you see it, Andy?
Carl, it's great to be with you again, and this is really an extraordinary conference out here. This Bioneers Conference brings together some of the most remarkable progressive people from the agricultural, social justice, and environmental community here, and it is a great opportunity for networking. It's just great out here. Yeah, Carl, that's one of the questions that a lot of us are asking here at this conference is, where is technology, where is this global economy taking us in these strange and difficult days we live in? As far as genetic engineering and nanotechnology, there's a lot of specific concerns that I have about its use in food, about cloning of human beings, about trying to rebuild nature at the molecular level through nanotechnology and living systems through genetic engineering. But there's a context to this which I like to sort of start with when we think about these technologies, because they can be very confusing and we can get lost in some of the scientific arcana that's involved in them. But one of the things I think is very, very clear, Carl, I just heard that September was the warmest month, warmest September in really the history of weather, of recorded weather. And with this whole new genre of global environmental threats, I think we're beginning to see that that our technological, our economic system simply is not compatible with living systems. They're just, the technologies we've developed, they create comfort, create leisure. In some ways, we think we can't live without them. But what's becoming really evident is that we probably can't live with them either, because they are really undermining the biochemistry of the planet and polluting this planet and using its resources at a rate that simply can't be sustained. But I think many of us in the progressive community, and Carl, you and I have talked about this for years, believe that we need to devolve our technologies. We need to change our technologies, make them more elegant, make them fit living systems. These mega technologies we have of energy production and factory farming and agriculture and virtually every one of the sectors we rely on is simply destroying life systems at too rapid a rate. We need to devolve our technologies. And just so our market system seems to be well suited to create wealth, but destroys the fabric of our society and once again utilizes our resources in a way that's not possible. So we assume that would change too. But with genetic engineering and nanotechnology, we see a whole new, sort of almost a breathtaking attempt by corporations, researchers, and many governments around the world. They're saying, let's not change our technology and our economics so it fits life. Let's change life so it fits our technological systems. So let's not worry so much about global warming. We're going to genetically engineer plants so they can survive drought and hot weather conditions. Let's not worry about a carcinogenic workplace, where we're causing mass disease among workers. Don't worry, we'll genetically engineer workers so they won't be as susceptible to cancers. And as far as those animals, I saw a researcher at Purdue University, one of the problems they have with egg-laying chickens is that they have a mothering instinct, so they want to brood over their eggs, which takes too long. So what these researchers have done, they've taken the mothering instinct genetically out of the chickens. So what they're saying is, we're not going to make more humane methods of getting food. We're actually going to change, the plants and animals that create our food so they fit this very inhumane technological system. So I think when you look at nanotechnology, which is trying to rebuild the inanimate world molecule by molecule to supply us with more resources, and genetic engineering, which is trying to rebuild life systems at the genetic level, it's this breathtaking, I think rather horrific attempt to try and not change our pathological ways of doing business and technology that are destroying the earth, but rather to try and change the very earth itself and all living systems to fit that technological system. And I think it's a very dangerous transformation in our use of technology. We've always thought of technology as sort of the tools we're going to use to help us in life. And now we're saying, no, technology is the tools we're going to use to recreate the universe at this nano level. And it's, to me, a really scary development.
How does that fit into corporate globalization?
Corporate globalization is based on this very dysfunctional model. You know, if you look at the market system, it's been very, very effective in creating wealth. But think of what it's done to societies. Think of what it's done to the natural world. You know, I caught the other day this statistic, which was shocking to me, which is that every day between 50 and 60 million Americans take psychotropic medication just to get through their workday, just to get through the day. You know, these are antidepressants, anti-anxiety. You know, this is major medication. And over 5 million kids, just to get through the school day, we have to drug them with psychotropic medication. They're the strongest medications we have. Even children under 2, over 500,000 are being medicated that way. And of course, our elder community that we put in these homes, because they're no longer, you know, functioning workers in our consumer society, we put them away. Their wisdom is put away in our old folks' homes. Of course, there's a massive overuse of medication for these people. So we're basically drugging ourselves so that we can put up with a system that creates wealth, but is dysfunctional for our spiritual, physical needs. You know, that, to me, that's really extraordinary. And then when you look at what the system is doing, when you're thinking about, you know, the 800 million people that go to bed hungry every night, when you think of the massive dislocation and violence that the kind of greed and avarice that's so much part of this system has created, it really is dysfunctional as far as its approach to society. But also the market system has absolutely no way of dealing with the fact that it is exploiting nature at a rate that is not sustainable. And it's two things really about this that I think are really important to remember. One is that the market capitalist system that we live under uses natural resources, but it doesn't put that use of natural resources into the price of an object. And it doesn't put the cost of the wasting and the exhaustion of those resources for future generations. Right? So the market can't say, listen, if we're exhausting oil now, what is it going to cost future generations to pay for this oil? We don't put that into our price. That's not into our equation. If we say water is rapidly disappearing around the planet for overuse, what's it going to cost our grandchildren and great-grandchildren to even get fresh water? What's that transaction cost? Will it even be possible? How is global warming, which we know is going to be terrific in its impacts, how is that going to affect future generations? None of that is put into the market transaction cost. And just so when we have our factory farming of food and we're polluting the waters and we're destroying biodiversity and we've literally eliminated in the last 50 years 10 million farmers and all those communities, all those jobs lost, all those livelihoods lost, all those hopes and dreams lost. How do you put that into the price of food? How do you put that into the price of what you see in the supermarket? So the prices that we think we're paying in the market are not the real costs, the environmental costs and the social costs that are there. And our entire global system, the World Trade Organization, the International Monetary Fund, the World Bank, they're all based on pushing this particular logic of production throughout the entire world. But what's really becoming clear and clear as we look at these environmental hazards and looming catastrophes, and we look at the social deremption we're seeing, this coming apart at the seams of our society, is that the logic of this mode of production fits neither the logic of life or the logic of society. You know, people saying, hey, this global economic system now, we're now beginning to realize with all the damage it's causing, we can't use a one-size-fits-all economics. I would argue this one size doesn't fit anything at all, that it's not good for society, it's not good for the environment. And their only answer to this, which is where it connects in with genetic engineering and nanotechnology, Carl, their only answer is don't worry. It is true, it's destroying society. It is true, it's destroying the environment, but that's what technology is for. We're going to be able to remake the human psyche, remake the plants and animal microbes, plants and animals of the earth, remake literally the inanimate parts of the earth so that we can have new resources at the molecular level. We're going to be able to redo all of this so we can keep this current system going. It's their last best hope. And I have no belief at all, by the way, that they're going to be successful in this. They're not going to be creating successful food through genetic engineering. They're not going to actually be able to remake the soils and earth of the world through nanotechnology. But I'm concerned that the failures, as they release these failed products, these failed nanorobots into the environment, I'm very, very concerned about what their failures are going to cost us, seeing what technology has done to us before.
In terms of genetic engineering, there are, well, the failures could impact on life, on the biological dynamics of life in the most profound ways.
That's right, Carl. I think with genetic engineering, and here we're talking about the genetic engineering of microbes and plants and animals, you know, they've done some amazing things. They've taken over 24 human genes and they've put them into animals and plants, and they took the genes from a flounder and put it in a tomato to create tomatoes that could grow at lower temperatures. They've taken human growth genes and put them into fish and to pigs to make them grow larger, and many of these creatures have failed. But the important thing to remember is they're now releasing hundreds of thousands of these organisms into the environment, is that this is biological pollution. You know, most of us, when we think of pollution, we think of a smokestack, or we think of sewage going into a river, or exhaust coming out of a car. But here we're talking about biological pollution. We're talking about living pollution, biological contamination, a living creature coming into an ecosystem and wrecking havoc. We remember with the, you know, the fungi that created chestnut blight and Dutch elm disease, that once we released them into the environment, there was no way to recall them. You can't get them back. They're going to grow. They're going to disseminate. They're going to mutate. They're going to create the destruction they're going to create, and there's just no way to control that destruction. So unlike even an oil spill, which is horrible as it is, dilutes over time. Biological pollution just grows and mutates, and you can't recall it. You know, there's these genetically engineered salmon that a company called Aqua Bounty has made up in Massachusetts. And that salmon's been engineered with growth genes to make it grow much larger. And that company's trying to get approval now to release that fish in the United States, release into the waters, bays, estuaries, rivers, because they want to create much larger salmon, something that will be more efficient, more profitable for them. Researchers at a number of universities now have looked at these salmon, and not just salmon, other fish that have been engineered with these growth genes. And what they found is that their larger growth makes them more attractive to female fish, for example, in reproduction. There's a tremendous percentage advantage for these larger fish in reproduction. But they also found, and get this, they also found that that larger size poorly impacted the salmon that were being born, so that there was 1/3 greater mortality among salmon that were the offspring of these genetically engineered salmon. So they have a tremendous advantage in reproduction, but 1/3 greater death rate of their offspring. They calculate that if only 60 of these genetically engineered salmon were to get into a native population of 60,000, there'd be extinction in less than 40 generations. I mean, it's a terrible arithmetic, but once you release these genetically engineered fish into the natural environment and that pollution starts, you're not going to be able to recall those fish. They're in the rivers, they're in the bays, the estuaries, you're not going to be able to get them back. And that terrible arithmetic begins, where if only 60 in a population of 60,000 causes extinction in less than 40 generations. That's biological contamination, that's biological pollution. And for all of the work we've done to try and protect Atlantic salmon or Pacific salmon, even one release of these fish could undo all of that in an irreversible and irretrievable way. And now that we're taking so many genes from so many species and mixing and matching them for fun and profit of Monsanto and other corporations, and we're releasing thousands of these microbes, plants, and animals into the environment, it's nothing but really a game of ecological roulette, where we don't know which ones, but we know many of them will create this biological contamination. And at some point, when enough of these novel organisms are in the environment, you could seriously and irreversibly destroy what we know as the web of life. You're going to have so many unknown ecological responses to these novel organisms that ecological catastrophe, if we don't stop this, it seems to me, is almost inevitable.
Nanotechnology. Now, I think many viewers aren't familiar with where it came from. I mean, suddenly nanotechnology is upon us. I mean, what are the roots of nanotechnology?
Well, the idea is, can we actually rebuild anything at the molecular level? It's the fundamental building block of both animate and inanimate existence. If you can fundamentally rebuild things at the molecular level, then you have the power of recreating literally the universe. So that's the sort of mad scientist view of this. Now, they're saying, hey, we might be able to use this as a more effective industrial technology. We can build new products with these nanorobots. And what nanorobots are, these molecular robots, as they call them, that can actually create new products by rearranging the molecules of these products. And they've actually designed these so they can do them. They've also designed several of these nanorobots with DNA, with genetic material, to try and they've created semi-living robots that can actually try and recreate living things as well as inanimate things at the molecular level. It is sort of an attempt to, as I said, you have the ultimate power of rebuilding the universe. And again, this is being driven by governments and corporations who see in this an enormous potential profit in the future. Imagine if you could rebuild the whole cosmos at your will and to your specifications, as much oil as you want, you know, as much wealth as you can create at the molecular level. And it definitely has a hubris to it. To me, it's one of the most frightening concepts that we're going to let our scientists and researchers doing that. But just last year, you know, the United States government, our taxpayer dollars went, almost $500 million went to more and more research into this nanotechnology and this whole idea of trying to rebuild the universe, again, at the will of corporations and some of their friends in government.
And corporate globalization, I mean, to some people it seems it's just being pushed along and driven along, inexorable. I mean, it's just like upon us. How can that be turned around? How can all of this? I mean, this is like a big Frankenstein movie with a dollar sign as its title.
Yeah, you know, this corporate juggernaut of globalization looked unstoppable, but what just happened in Cancun last month is that it got stopped. And what's happening is that in a time of economic decline, more and more countries are saying, we don't want this market model, and we certainly don't want it from America, and we still don't want American corporations doing it to us. We want to be able to develop our own economies and not constantly have American and other first world companies coming in, taking our resources, exploiting us for cheap labor, exploiting our environment, and getting the profit. That's got to stop. And a number of nations came together at a recent Cancun meeting and said to the United States, 22 nations, India, Brazil, China, and said, no, we're not taking it anymore. This model of corporate globalization is just not working for us. And the answer is no. And they've had very good reason, Carl, for saying that. If you look at the devastation that's happened to the Russian economy, to many of the economies throughout Southeast Asia, to what's going on in South America right now with Argentina and potentially in Brazil, I mean, these are functioning societies that were destroyed by this market model, just destroyed with massive starvation, unemployment, social unrest. This is so people can say, we have the poster children for what corporate globalization has done to the world, the suffering that it's created. And a lot of other countries are looking at that saying, no way, we're not going to do that. And maybe, you know, the last country that's really been hit by this is the United States. We've seen the stock market drop, massive increase in unemployment, increase in poverty, decrease in the number of people that have health insurance. I mean, we're watching the third worldization, if you will, of the United States right now. But here's the key point. Unlike Argentina and Russia and those countries in Southeast Asia who were destroyed by globalization but had no choice, the United States said, you know, we have an alternative. We can go and get the wealth and resources we need. And I think that's the real reason behind the war in Iraq and any other country where we can get oil, we can get water. We can actually have a new American empire. And so you've seen a complete change in American foreign policy. From when you had the first Bush presidency, you had this one world united under market principles, you know, harmonizing to get together. If there needed to be a war against a particular rogue state, we could do it. Now you have a very different image of American policy, an American empire that very much like the British and the French empires in the colonial age of the 19th century and 18th century are going out and saying, we're going to get the resources we need. It's a social Darwinian world out there. We're going to go out and get those resources. We're going to seize them. We're going to use military violence, shock and awe if we have to. We're going to scare the world's population and saying, hey, you better give us what we want. And that's how we're going to survive the failure of economic and corporate globalization, which was our mantra, but now has failed us as long as the rest of the world. And that is the American alternative to globalization. And I don't think the rest of the world is taking to it kindly. We've already turned ourselves into kind of a pariah. And I think you can see a continuation of that as these policies continue.
In terms of other nightmares, which we must unfortunately mention, I quote Andy Kimbrell, our nuclear technology has put all of humanity and the Earth itself on a computer trip line to Armageddon. Nuclear technology, Andy.
Yeah, you know, one of the things that we, whenever we talk about nanotechnology or biotechnology, I always think we approach these technologies with kind of a technological amnesia, if you will. You know, we act like we're talking about technology for the first time. But, you know, if you look at the X-ray and then look what's happening with the proliferation of nuclear weapons, clearly we didn't just limit nuclear technology to its beneficial purposes. As you point out, Carl, it continues to threaten the very existence of the planet, and in some very disturbing ways, as you've written on so compellingly, with certain kinds of satellite and other delivery system technologies. if you look at what happened with a few, you know, the early in history of the chemical revolution, yes, we said plants grow better with this kind of fertilizer. Here's a way to kill a pest. Now we have literally thousands of untested pesticides in our environment. We've got an epidemic of cancer. We've got waste we cannot dispose of. And through our chemical revolutions, we've created global warming and ozone depletion, which threaten to disrupt and permanently disrupt the very biochemistry and survival of our planet. We have never limited these technologies to their beneficial purposes. And I think it's extraordinarily naive that now when people talk about biotechnology or nanotechnology, they even dare tell us, oh, don't worry. Don't worry. We're not going to use these for military purposes. Oh, we'll only use these for the good of the people, not for the good of corporations. Well, we're already seeing both biotechnology and nanotechnology, a lot of military research-driven and biological weapon research, which we have funded in this country for 20 years. We're seeing it being used for corporation and only for corporate needs and not for the public good. So we're seeing the same repeat of the problems. We have the nuclear revolution that have led to this looming problem that we continue to have with nuclear destruction, with chemical pollution, which now threatens our planet. We're now seeing with these two even more intimate, even more powerful technologies, genetic engineering and nanotechnology, still corporate run, we're seeing the same mistakes we made with these past technologies. The good news is that these are still at the early stages of development, and we're seeing a new consciousness. They're arising within the framework of a new ecological consciousness among people in this country and around the world. And what really makes, you know, gives me a huge amount of energy in the struggles that we're fighting these corporate control of nanotechnology and biotechnology, and trying to control the technologies themselves, is the energy I see around the world for people saying, you know what, we're going to just say no to this technology until we really understand the ecological consequences, the social consequences. We're not going to keep making those mistakes that we made with prior technologies. And wherever I go, and this is certainly true of Cancun, it's certainly true right here outside of San Francisco and San Rafael, there is a whole new movement of people that are saying, we are never going to accept these corporate technologies on face value again. We're going to make sure that our human values control these technologies and not continue this pattern where these technologies control human choices.
Andy, I mean, somebody watching this could easily get depressed. I mean, I can't imagine more depressing subjects. What's the average person to do? You talk, you know, about challenging, but what channels do you suggest the challenge go through? What are people to do?
You know, Carl, what I find, again, so exciting is the fastest growing agriculture in the United States is organic agriculture. So, you know, while the corporate agribusiness boys are saying, hey, listen, we're going to put more and more pesticides in the food, we're going to genetically engineer food, you know, food's going to end up looking like the food you used to look for the Jetsons. Remember the old TV show with a tablet and they were drinking Tang? You know, that was their future of food. And people en masse said, no, that is not the food future we want. You know, we're not just going to be consumers of your food. We're going to be creators. We're going to create a new future of food. We're going to create a new way that links farmers, you know, with the public. We're going to create a new way that protects our rivers and our air, that protects our bodies and the bodies of our children. And that's how the whole movement of organic food started about 25 years ago. And it has become, as I said, the fastest growing food there is in America. It's just amazing. And it swept the world. There's now organic standards literally worldwide. Almost everybody who's into socially responsible investment are coming up to me saying, how can I get into this new organic revolution? And, you know, if you even look at small things, you know, look how women are giving birth to children these days. You know, they used to think, oh, it's going to be this highly, you know, technologized, the doctor puts you to sleep, don't worry about it. And women, again, around this country and in Europe said, you know what, we're not going to do it that way. We want to actually experience what this feels like. So, again, they said no to a particular kind of technology because they wanted a more authentic experience. And I think that here we have a really crucial, you know, dramatic moment, not just in the history of food and the history of certain medical practices, but in the history of technology itself. Because technology has really thrived, modern, I mean, mega technologies, in the way they've been able to separate people from the consequences of those technologies. For example, think for a minute of the Happy Meal, you know, the McDonald's Happy Meal. Imagine if that family in that commercial was there at the slaughterhouse to see the incredible, unspeakable cruelty being done to those animals. Think there'd still be a happy smile on the kid's face? Be shrieking in horror. What if they were there to see the forest being cut down, burned, and the creatures running or being burned alive that created the pasture land necessary for those animals? Still a happy meal? It's the saddest meal in the world when you think about it. But we, through our advertising and through the fact that we're an urban culture often separated from the consequences of our technology, you know, we haven't always made those connections. But I think increasingly over the last 20, 30 years, thank goodness Rachel Carson, I guess this was the 40th anniversary of her Silent Spring, who said, listen, these pesticides are affecting our bodies. We can no longer be separate from their consequences. I remember Cesar Chavez right here in California saying, you know what? Every time you buy a grape, you need to think about the consequences of the pesticides to the men and women and children that are picking those grapes. And you need to boycott people that aren't doing that in a way that protects those children and those families. People are making those connections, and they're saying, you know, we don't want nuclear technology because we know the long-term consequences. We know there's 100,000-year half-life we can't control. They're making the connections. And so I think that that's where you're seeing the people's movements around the world rising up against corporate globalization, saying no to genetically engineered foods, saying no to nanotechnology, saying no to nuclear power. And it's happening around the world, and just last month, again in Cancun, they said no to corporate globalization in a way I think that does almost a death blow to that particular movement. So I think it's not at all a depressing time. I think this is one of the most exciting times I can imagine for anyone out there who's an activist. We're actually seeing real victories in many of these major areas, in foods, in technology, in global politics, in undermining corporate power. We're seeing tremendous advances, and we're seeing things that were thought to be technological or economic juggernauts, unstoppable, they have been stopped. So, Carl, I think it's I'm very optimistic. I think it's a very encouraging and very exciting time to be involved in this work.
And just, if I can ask you, Andy, how was it that you put it together, began to understand the profound dangers of technology?
There's no question that when you look at our world today, technology is the primary engine of social change. If you think of nuclear power, the automobile, the combustion engine, technologies change our lives more than anything else, you know. And the ironic thing is that if you go to, you know, Washington, see the bills they're voting on, where I work in Washington, D.C., they're relatively unimportant quite often. And the big decisions on technology, whether we're going to develop nuclear weapons, whether we're now going to alter and change the very genetic structure of all living organisms, whether we're going to try and molecularly change the basis of all life and animate matter on Earth, we don't have a democratic process for that. Only a few corporations and bureaucrats control those decisions. And so I determined early on that you cannot call yourself a democratic society if you're not making democratic decisions about the things that are going to affect your life the most. So I think it's long overdue that we've seen this world movement saying, you know what, we're not simply going to accept these technologies. Again, we're going to make sure that human choices and human values control these technologies and not continue a world where a few corporations, researchers, and their technology continue to determine our human choices and destroy the natural system on which we all depend.
Amen, Andy Kimbrell. Thank you so much, Andy. Thank you.
Carl, what a pleasure to be with you again.
Thank you for your work.
Carl,
Andy has been described as one of the world's leading 100 visionaries. Again, many thanks. I'm Carl Grossman. You've been watching Enviro Close Up. And for a copy of this or any Enviro video program, just visit our website at www.envirovideo.com.